So I just want to begin this exciting afternoon session by introducing Professor Meir Shachar from Tel Aviv University, who's here with us, and he's going to be the chair of this whole afternoon panel. Professor Shachar is an expert on China and is working in the past few years, more specifically, on the movement of cultural ideas and cultural paradigms from the Indian subcontinent to China. So he's a particularly suitable chair for this session. Thank you, Meir, for
thank you, Igal, and thank you for this wonderful conference that you arranged for all of us. Really, thank you. And we are going to have an exciting session this afternoon in which we go beyond the Indian subcontinent to explore the impact of Sanskrit poetics in general and Dandin's mirror in particular on Central Asia, Tibet, Mongolia, China, and Japan. And we go in this order, first Tibet, then further north, Mongolia, and then east China, and further east to Japan. And our first two speakers are two renowned Tibetologists, Janet Gyatso from Harvard University and Pema Boom, who is director of the Lhotse Library, and they will speak. And
here,
I'm already failing in my role of the of chair.
Actually, we changed the title.
We changed the title. So the title is Beyond Despairing, the Kavya Darsha, the Dalai Lama, and Mr. Smart Tibetan. So.
Thank you very much. I just want to say that this paper is really a joint project between Pema Boom and myself. We work together very closely. Mostly the examples and the material were provided by Pema. I put the words together, but it's really written by the two of us, and it's a product of our conversation. And so we had the thought to, we're actually going to read it, we're going to go sort of go back and forth reading it by paragraph by paragraph. However, just now Pema told me that when he was just reading through his parts, he found that only his parts, which is about half the paper, took 40 minutes. So if we find that it's going too long, I'm maybe better at talking really fast in English. And so I may jump in and finish the paper because we want to try to finish.
Thank you. Yeah. Maybe you need some more patience for my reading. My reading is so slow and sometimes not so clear, probably. Okay, I'll try my best. Never had the experience and the realization of the likes of the Marpa and the Mila. Didn't reach the level of the mastery of Shong and Pang. Stuck with the wealth or power on the peak of the mountain, the useless life of a man comes to an end.
With these words, the fifth Dalai Lama of Tibet, Ngawang Losang Gyatso, his dates are 1617 to 1682, in his lengthy commentary on Dandan's Kavya Darsha, illustrates an example of dismissal through remorse, an anushaya akshepa. Now, akshepa is a literary device whereby, as Bronner puts it, the poet deploys the aesthetics of saying no, which is actually quite appropriate that I'm citing you, to try to disallow something. And the type of dismissal through remorse appears to be a move to disallow a sense of satisfaction. So as Dandan put his own example of this figure.
I earned no money, gained no knowledge, did nothing for my soul. I lived a long life, but wasted it all.
That's Bronner's translation. Dandan presents the verse as an old man's lament about the failure of his life. It represents what such a person might say. But in the hands of the Dalai Lama, the verse marked by the figure of Anushayakshepa, while in some ways closely parallel to the original example, highlights the ingrediency of the author in the figure. Here, the fact that the verse is uttered by someone else, namely the man on top of the mountain, brings out a comparison with the author, the Dalai Lama himself, who is pointedly not on top of a mountain, but is usefully spending his life in the Potala Palace as king of Tibet, certainly possessing wealth and power, and most of all possessing learning, by which he is referring specifically here to learning in Kavya theory on a par with that of Shong and Peng, the Tibetan translator of the Kavya Darsha and the work's first Tibetan commentator. In fact, the verse is simultaneously addressed to the man on the mountain and uttered by him, by virtue of the Dalai Lama's transformation of the figure into a kind of ironic and spiteful ventriloquy. The Dalai Lama is suggesting that the man on the mountain ought to utter this verse, while the Dalai Lama himself is enjoying a moment of gleeful schadenfreude. We have no question the Dalai Lama is addressing the Kagyu masters, his nemesis, both politically in Tibetan history, but also as competitors for the claim of master of the art of Kavya. Perhaps we should call the figure of Akshepa here inhibition rather than dismissal. The Dalai Lama is using it to decommission his opponents by making them feel bad about themselves. And indeed, surely sometimes meditators on top of mountains must wonder if they made the right career choice after all.
Dantin's brilliant Kabir Dasha stands in tradition of Sanskrit poetic theory with a highly sophisticated appreciation of manifold power of language. Particularly self-consciously deployed poetic language to communicate with one's fellow human beings on many registers. For Tibetans who had already received so much of value from Indian civilization, primarily in the realm of the Buddhism religion, the discovery
of Alankar Shastra,
and particularly the Kabir Dasha was an absolute epiphany. It quickly became a massive symbol to Tibetans of how sophisticated literature can be and how sorely lacking in sophistication was Tibetan language, which indeed had remained oral up the 7th century. When Tibetan invented a system of writing as a part of effort to translate Buddhist text into their language, it was only in the 13th century that the great Tibetan scholar Sacha Panchita, 1182-1251, presented the riches of the Kabir Dasha to Tibetan intelligentsia for the first time. Quickly thereafter, Kabir Dasha was translated into Tibetan by Shongtun Dorji Jamsen, the translator mentioned in the Dalai Lama's verse. In about 1270, the first Tibetan commentary on Kabir Dasha was composed by Banglo Zawa Lodi Tenpa, 1276-1342. It's the beginning of the 14th century. It continued to be subject of a large number of other Tibetan commentaries thereafter. In fact, new ones are still being written in our day. The Kabir Dasha is still studied assiduously by students in Tibetan high school in China today. This movement started in the 80s after end of the Cultural Revolution. Included the high first, like me, probably first generation studied the Kabir Dasha in school. That's in college. Then later included the curriculum, the high school. Now it's keep going. This paper is about the role of the Kabir Dasha in Tibetan capital of Lhasa during the 17th century. It is about how the tools of Kabir Dasha served Tibetan to communicate linguistically in a way that could accommodate the
intricacies
and overdetermination of social negotiation. This was especially useful in fraught and delicate realm politics. both in terms of power over the land and the, in terms of the cultural politics prestige and cosmopolitan prowess. Our examples will be the writing on Kabir Dasha by the great 5th Dalai Lama, Lozong Jiangzu, himself the major force behind cultural climate in 17th century capital, who in 1642 created the Garden Pouchang, the United Tibetan State, which remained in power until the 14th Dalai Lama was forced to flee Tibet in 1959. In tandem with the Dalai Lama's commentary, we will also examine writings on Kabir Dasha by Bukhiba Mipungela Namgyel, 1618-1685, a close contemporary of the 5th Dalai Lama and apparently an active member of the court. Despite his affiliation with the Gaju school and thereby
tendentious
relationship with the Dalai Lama, as well as with the Dalai Lama famous regent Sangji Jiangzu, like the Dalai Lama himself, Bukhiba, his name means smart guy of Tibet, in bracket, was a leading intellectual of the time. We also know of his fine writing on medicine, medicinal history and theory.
And by the way, I just will add that Pema just told me that he's one of three of the finest writers of messenger poetry in Tibetan history. Yeah. I think you should read next paragraph,
okay.
And then maybe I might read the rest, much okay. as we like.
Okay.
You could read maybe the poems, and I'll read the rest, only because we need to move faster.
Okay.
So, I'm sorry.
As in the example already examined, Dalai Lama directed a number of beaten barbs of the Gaju school in his commentary to Kabir Dasha. The Dalai Lama commentary also incorporated another genre of Tibetan writing about the Kabir Dasha, namely his exercise book, or Beju. A special genre wherein students of the Kabir Dasha compose their own poems to illustrate each of the figures described in Kabir Dasha. Usually, a commentary and an exercise book are published separately. But in the Dalai Lama's case, he mixed them together, commenting on the root text and then providing an explanatory poem of his own composition. It is not exactly clear why the 5th Dalai Lama was so aggressive and often quite rude towards this venerable lineage of Marpa and Milarepa in Tibet, but it is almost certainly because of the war that his supporters fought with the supporters of the Gwajipa school during process of the consolidating power in central Tibet, prior to 1642.
And I'll just say that when we first started working on this, Pema was really highlighting the fact of how rude can be the 5th Dalai Lama. Okay, while this is not made explicit either, it's commonly thought that Pukheba's own commentary to the Kabir Dasha, as well as his exercise book, served as a response to the Dalai Lama's barbs and was an effort to defend his Kagyu masters from the Dalai Lama's insufferable remarks. However, he himself owns up to this only elliptically. For example, a brief statement at the start of his Kabir Dasha only says, "I'm not going to comment on this text in crooked ways, and I'm not going to contaminate my refutations with muddy water. My work is to straighten out issues in Dundan's exposition without confusion." Now, at least the readers of this statement, according to Pema Bum, are convinced that Smart Tibetan is contrasting the good work that he himself will do in his commentary with the irrelevant machinations and diatribes that muddy the one by the Dalai Lama. But let us not fail to note, finally, by the way, that the fact that nothing needs to be said entirely explicitly, even about one's own intentions in writing a commentary, is one of the great virtues that Kavya Darsha teaches. By deploying the literary devices of the Kavya Darsha, both the Dalai Lama and especially Pukheba, and remember, Dalai Lama is king of Tibet, Pukheba could voice otherwise dangerous sentiments without getting nailed for so doing. What this paper will be showing in part is that in Tibet, not only did the Kavya Darsha introduce much to students about the art of literary composition and literary analysis, it could also be a tool that allowed people to say things without having said them, but then again, to have said them, and perhaps even more powerfully than if they just said it straight, like, you're no good or you're an idiot. Somehow using innuendo and double meanings and irony is even more effective in making someone feel bad about themselves in contrast to the great me. So we only have time for a few choice examples, but what we see in each of them will serve to show how central the study of Kavya Darsha's poetic theory was to Tibetan culture, or dare we say civilization, especially in the capital in this important century, 17th century. Let's turn first perhaps to the biggest issue of all in the reception of Kavya Darsha in Tibet, an issue which is perhaps especially shared by its reception also in Sri Lanka, as we heard yesterday. And it has to do with the intersection or not between Buddhism, which is indeed the most cultural, most important cultural force in Tibetan history, and Kavya. Now, the field of Tibetan studies is only recently looking at the so-called secular literature of Tibet. A classic category for classifying such writing is the old Buddhist rubric of the Vidyasthanas, often translated as secular sciences. The main list of five includes medicine, linguistics, arts and crafts, and logic, but there's other lists that add Kavya, dramaturgy, astrology, and so on. All of these fields had great import in Tibetan centers of learning, but their place in a specifically Buddhist curriculum, that is, in monastic institutions, was in dispute. And the two Vidyasthanas with perhaps the highest controversiality and also the greatest impact on Tibetan culture more generally were medicine and poetics. I recently wrote a book about medicine, which was a very vital field of learning, but was subject to doubt since its main systems of knowledge could only very tentatively be attributed to the Buddha. And also because it directly contradicted central elements of Buddhist tantric anatomy and physiology. Poetics were a problem for a different reason, not because of issues of textual authority, but rather because its subject was strongly associated with erotic love and other sensual pleasures and anathema to Buddhist monasticism. In fact, it appears that while most of the, not all, but most of the major commentaries to the Kavya Darsha were indeed prominent Buddhist monks, the study of Kavya Darsha took place in special seminars outside the monastic curriculum and outside the main institution of the learning. One sign of this tension may again be found in the Dalai Lama's Kavya Darsha commentary. This time, an example of prag abhava hetu. The figure illustrates a particular kind of causation wherein it is an absence of something that serves as a cause. Dundon illustrates it like this.
Okay. No real education, no heed to the ways, and the lack of self-control, man's surest way to disaster.
So that's Dundon.
Mm-hmm.
And the Kavya Darsha, the Dalai Lama's verse reads as follows.
Didn't sit in the role of a Mahamudra meditator. Didn't nurture the biographies of all the great gurus. Didn't wrap human life around the mere
sophistry.
Thereby did I achieve Xiong and Pang's level of mastery.
Sorry, somehow the first line dropped off of that. First of all, we can note that in contrast to our first example illustrating Anushayakshepa, the Dalai Lama is using the figure of causation due to absence to talk about himself. And also in contrast to the failure of the Kagyubas to do anything useful with their lives, here for the Dalai Lama, the failure to do a list of things is good. And finally, the Dalai Lama's use of the figure is quite different from Dundon's, whereas Dundon uses it to showcase the conventional wisdom that education, wisdom, and discipline lead to good things, and their absence leads to disaster. Figure of the non-existing cause in the past for the Dalai Lama serves to make a really a rather surprising claim. So the three principal activities that the Dalai Lama says he hasn't done, which are meditation, guru yoga, and philosophical debate, that adds up to what Tibetan Buddhism is all about. And he's saying that he didn't do it, and that's what allowed him to be a great master of kavya. It's pretty surprising for the Dalai Lama, who distanced himself from Buddhist practice, and it's, of course, a bit of a hyperbole. The Dalai Lama did perform sadhanas and countless Buddhist rituals, and he also wrote biographies of the lamas. But on the other hand, it is true, actually, that most of his writing is about history or governmental ordinances or kavya. And what's more, the third line is a real jab at Buddhist philosophical debate, which the Dalai Lama dubs sophistry, which was the specialty of the Dalai Lama's own school of Buddhism. Most of all, the verse is a real sign of how poetics was inching the Tibetan court, and with it, Tibetan culture away from the so-called Buddhist hegemony in Tibet. In this, kavya seemed to signify something more secular than medicine for the Dalai Lama. In fact, the Dalai Lama wanted to prove that medicine really was Buddhism, but for kavya, he was willing to say it's not Buddhist at all. We see further evidence of this in the Dalai Lama's comment on something about the very first work of the Kavya Darsha, where Dandan is beseeching the goddess Saraswati to remain for a long time in his mind. We were talking about that this morning a little bit, and just reproducing the verse from the Kavya Darsha. This is not a Bronner translation. I'm not sure where I got it. May the lovely lady swan, the all-white Saraswati, who sports amidst the lotus mouth of Brahma, roam forever in delight in the lotus pool of my heart. So in the course of this discussion, the Dalai Lama is criticizing the famous Tibetan historian, Tsula Trangwa, another major Tibetan scholar. And Tsula Trangwa, in his own commentary, said that some people have said that this first verse is talking about visualization of Saraswati, in which Dundan was addressing Saraswati in front of him. He was visualizing her in front of him, and others have interpreted the verse to mean that Dundan is actually visualizing himself as Saraswati. So when Tsula Trangwa says this, he's using technical tantric Buddhist terminology about the varying degrees of identification with a deity that a meditator can achieve. But the Dalai Lama berates such views as big talk that even scholars have never heard of, and goes on to name a few other arcane practices that the Kagyupas do, such as identifying Vikalpa and Dharmakaya and stuff like that. That's the kind of stuff you Kagyupas are always talking about, the Dalai Lama says. Wow, applying technicalities from Buddhist Tantra, even the translators and panditas have never heard of it. Applying the Buddhist Tantra to Kavya Shastra, a Shastra which is common to Buddhists and non-Buddhists, that's really great, he says sarcastically. And maybe you should make Artha Alamkara into Abhisheka. Maybe you should make Shabda Alamkara into this so-called permission ritual. Maybe you should make a Prahelaka into the introduction to the mind transmission, the Dalai Lama goes on. Then you'll really have made the Mahamudra teachings really beautiful. Actually, what the Dalai Lama just suggested is rather interesting, that the use of poetic figures could confer special religious illumination on their readers, much like religious transmission rituals. But it's clear he's being very sarcastic. And most of all, the point he's objecting to is the mixing, the confusing of knowledge systems. It's precisely this realization and mentality we think that signals the relativization of Buddhism in Tibetan Lhasa culture in the 17th century. Kavya is not Buddhism, and kavya is a good thing. These are the two messages we can take away from the foregoing. So the mixing of systems is also key to a major conceptual dispute regarding the very structure of the Kavya Darsha, in which the Dalai Lama and Pukhebe are engaged. This time it's clear that Pukhebe is replying directly to the Dalai Lama's view. And I'm going to start summarizing a little bit because I'm afraid about time. the Dalai Lama mentions the fact that in the discussion in the Kavya Darsha on the first chapter, that there is where he makes the basic distinction, Dandan makes the basic distinction between the body of Kavya and the Alamkaras. That's the two main categories. Once again, he was criticizing others who tried to introduce new categories into that discussion, and he just dismisses them out of hand. As you know, Dandan didn't say it, so why are you saying it? But then he proceeds to introduce his own new category, which he attributes to his predecessor in Tibetan history, that you really need to add a third category to body and ornament, and that is life force, or sok, probably best translated as jiva. It's not clear exactly the translation of this word in Sanskrit. So just as one would decorate a person's beautiful life force endowed body with ornaments, in the same way these alamkaras decorate a verse and the prose or a mixture that constitutes the body of Kavya that expresses the four kinds of fruits. And he says, actually, the notion of life force actually pervades all of Kavya. This is a major intervention, and he's actually attributed it to one medical writer. Very surprising that he has his own commentary on the Kavya Darsha. But we haven't been able to find that. But anyway, it's there. But now for Pokheba's response. This is where Pokheba tries to nail the Dalai Lama. So Pokheba actually cites Zurigawa's statement. He says, by using the metaphors of a person's body, life force, and ornaments, it's what makes possible the four fruits of Kavya, the moksha, dharma, artha, and kama. And if you don't have this category of life force, you're not ever going to understand how Kavya works. So it's a kind of interesting idea, but Pokheba is very distressed with it. He goes on to remark sarcastically, Zurigawa thinks he's found a good understanding that others have never noticed. He says, the Kavya Darsha itself says that body and ornaments, so Pokheba starts citing all these Tibetan scholars who have said that actually there's just these two categories, body and ornament. And these people, you know, all these very famous scholars have the flow of the Indian scholars' teachings, and they only give the two categories. But you, being overcome with the habit traces or the vasanas of medicine, have in mind the saying that if it lacks life force, who would take a man's corpse, however good? But Pokheba goes on, there can be ornaments on a chariot or a palace or a belt. We see many cases where ornament can beautify a substance that has no life force. Where is the necessity that this case of poetics is the same as the case of a person's body, life force, and ornaments? Even if Kavya is like a human body, then if you definitely need the life force, why do you not also need the faculties, such as the eye faculty? The present case is not the same as the case of an ornament that will not beautify a naked body. We'll come back to that. How can you assume it is? If you think that the mention of a body indirectly must assume that there's a life force, why does not ornament also assume indirectly that there's also clothing? Because of your excessive attachment to your example, you have made dirty something was delivered clean. Or is it that the teacher Dandan was not skillful in his composition? And so on. So he makes an important point about the danger of insisting that the implicit notion of life force in any talk of the body would best be made explicit. We don't really know actually what they had in mind about this notion of life force because we haven't been able to find the original text that talks about it. But we might mention Gintin Trimpel, this was Pema's idea to try to explain it, who is famous for having said that he could read the words and he understood the poetic devices of English poetry, But he couldn't taste an English poem because he didn't know the way that people really talked in England. So we're just guessing, maybe the Tibetan category of life force in the context of kavya refers to the emotive taste of a poem. Perhaps Perkeba and the other critics thought that this notion of vitality or soul was already implicit in kavya darsha, and were really worried about the proliferation of categories. Some kind of idea here, and I'm not sure where this is coming from, that he's also saying that once you add this one category, you're going to have to add others, using this example of that you can't decorate a naked body. So once you have a naked body, which I don't understand, but then that means you have to have clothing and so on and so forth. But maybe the most interesting point to draw your attention to here is the insistence on system, the fault of mixing systems. That Zurgawa, the guy who introduced this idea, because he works with human bodies, he got confused and he couldn't see kavya as a system on its own and was confusing them. And it's very important to protect the boundaries of where poetry begins and ends. Okay, but in addition to these issues, there's also, I would say, a very big part of the electricity between Perkeba and the fifth Dalai Lama is less about these theoretical or substantive questions about kavya and more about electricity, electrical flash, pure rhetoric, poetry as an occasion to score prestige, to advance a claim of mastery, and more convincingly than the others. Even the examples we've just looked at themselves seem to be primarily about who knows more about the authoritative system. How could you know more than Dundon? I know what Dundon knew, and so on. I'm just going to give you a couple examples, and then we can discuss. We're actually doing okay. All right, so let us give you a few examples where the kavya darsha was ingredient in the culture of prestige, such as the endeavor of writing a commentary or this seemingly innocent schoolboy's exercise book could become a medium for sly insults to one's nemesis and their teachings and lineage. So Perkeba does this just as much as the fifth Dalai Lama. So we're going to turn to his exercise book to see his example of the figure of sama sokti, or terseness in expression, whereby one can refer to something by talking about something else that has similar attributes. In this case, Perkeba is illustrating the subtype, which is bina abina visheshana, where attributes are only partly alike. So they're partially alike and partially not alike. So first of all, we have Dundon's example of this again.
The swath of the bow is not small, and there is a wealth of fruits and flowers. The shelter is good, and its giver is strong. Thank God I found this tree.
That's Bronner.
Bronner's translation.
So according to Bronner, I think it's Ratnashri who said that the bough and the wealth of fruits is applicable only to the tree, whereas the ability to give shelter and be strong is common to both a tree and a man. So here is Perkeba's example. Oh, and by the way, this is an illustration of the strange animal that he's going to invoke, which is partially lion and partially a Garuda, who supposedly has 8 feet, although this illustration only has 4 feet.
Included two wings.
Oh yeah, two wings. Six. Yes. So there's 6 feet here, but not the 8. So here's Perkeba's verse.
Yeah.
With the taut shape of an 8-footed lion Garuda, he is forever posed haughtily in the monastery, looking super awesome. He performs his duty, but he's actually inanimate. It's a child's mind, who would find this wondrous. Again, nowhere does Pokeba admit, again, see the similarities between this and the Dunedin, but it's being twisted. Nowhere does Pokeba admit that he's talking about the Dalai Lama, but there can be no question that the powerful person he's mocking is the most powerful ruling, the ruler of his era, and this is certainly how the verse is received. Smart Tibetan mocks the Dalai Lama's power as mere posture, like a statue or painting, in a position that can be assumed but does not actually require animation or intelligence. One can be the Dalai Lama as a mere figurehead, a statue that does not need implied talent of any kind. In other words, the Dalai Lama is brandishing his position but that does not guarantee his true accomplishment as a scholar or sage. For Smart Tibetan, only a child would be impressed with this. This is really a slam of the whole reincarnation phenomenon in Tibet. There's others in Tibet who have criticized this reincarnation for these very problems. But again, notice how Pokeba, who is the exact contemporary of the fifth Dalai Lama and in his court, you know, has to be very careful by making such a claim about the fifth Dalai Lama. Actually, at one point in our study of all these things, I asked Pema Bloom whether these verses were kind of a joke, whether they were fun. And Pamela said no. He said they're dead serious. Okay. Okay, one more example. This one is a illustration of one of the subtypes of leisha, concealment, whereby one deploys a different explanation for something than what is really true in order to confer either blame or praise. The particular subtype is the use of artifice of praise actually to deflate someone. So as Bronner puts it, it is a eulogy constructed in such a way that it ends up being nothing but criticism. So here's Dunedin's example. This king
is young and upright. A friend, future husband, and a hero, too. He cares even more about winning a war than about making love to his woman.
Okay, so as Dunedin explains the verse, it allows a verse of seeming praise actually to work to dissuade a woman from considering the king as a potential husband, since in fact she's most interested in his ability to make love. So it sounds like a praise, but it isn't. And we have a very similar example with the Pokeba or Smart Tibetan's verse about, about the Dalai Lama.
The God of beings during the fallen era is in the full of bloom of youth. He has mastered all of the teachings on the terminology of a convention, and without attaching himself to any inner yoga at all, he has managed to hold the victorious one's teaching by virtue of explanation, debate, and composition.
First of all, if you notice, this one actually echoes the brag of the fifth Dalai Lama that we looked at earlier when he said he didn't do any meditation and he only mastered the terminology of convention. By the way, I just want to point out of the many references that have come up already, I think Charlie was talking about this big debate between the mystical experience and ultimate truth and relative truth. This is very much at the heart of this debate between Pokeba and well. But here, again, just very briefly, you can see how totally sarcastic he is and how clever the verse is. You know, it's praising him. You know, what he studied is all these conventional terminologies, which we have deepest know are useless. And oh my God, he didn't ever do inner yoga at all, and he's managed to hold the victorious one teachings. Can be terrific, but it's also like, you know, he never did any inner yoga, and he assumes that he can be the holder of the victorious one teaching. This is outrageous. Okay, we are going to
just conclude now with just a couple of very brief comments. Okay, one thing that strikes us in the back and forth between Tibet's powerful leader and an intellectual in the court is how the very mechanism of learning facilitates, if not engenders, social interaction and the creation of values. This observation turns on how closely we have seen the Tibetan poetic examples follow the images originally offered by Dundin's verses to illustrate the same figures. We're very interested in this notion of the,
Yes. We find this whole practice of writing the exercise book extremely interesting, this pejum. But it seems, so at least we can say now, it seems to be the case as the student of Kavya proceeds one by one through the Alamkaras, the examples given in the original text of Dundin inspire a close approximation in the student's exercise book, although now intended to refer something in the fledgling poet's own range of imagination or as relevant to his own life. So writing poems will inevitably reflect one's own experience, but they come up in the order of the poems provided in the Kavya Darsha. This produces a rather odd effect because it seems rather random, because the order in the Kavya Darsha is to illustrate these various principles of ornamentation. But for the student writing, it's almost sort of like a Rorschach exercise of what does this inspire you to think about. But maybe it's the very randomness that frees the imagination. So while it's not the case that when smart Tibetan responds to the Dalai Lama that he's using the exact same Alamkara, but, you know, lo and behold, as the exercise goes on, here you find a mention of a king and all of a sudden says, okay, Pekeba says to himself, okay, here's a good place to slam the Dalai Lama. Remember kings? You know, that dumb king who never did any meditation. But this doesn't mean that that makes the exercise trivial or merely idiosyncratic. Rather, the discipline of regularly writing examples of Alamkara in the Kavya Darsha provides an arena in which a variety of political, social, and religious concerns, as well as certainly autobiographical ones, come to be suggested and then formulated, expressed, eventually part of public discourse and memory. So just a final paragraph. The mere number of Tibetan Kavya Darsha commentaries and exercise books in Tibet and the degree of precision with which the text was studied, memorized, and heeded shows what a significant force in the creation of culture that it was. Unlike in other cases in South Asia where the study of Kavya Darsha prompted detailed reflection on how the language group in question relates to things Sanskritic, for Tibetan there was not really a question of relation to any Indic language at all. Rather, Tibetans merely accepted the work as a foreign but brilliant treatise on poetics with valuable insights on writing and literary culture in general. They took it and they ran with it. Tibetan writing has never been the same. In our first paper for the seminar, we talked about the resistance to Kavya Darsha in Tibetan history. But the truth of the matter is that it always was a very complex combination, a veritable love-hate relationship with Kavya Darsha in Tibet. And we feel like we've just touched the tip of the iceberg, we think, with the examples we offer today.
So thank you for... Anyway, thank you for a wonderful talk. It's really astonishing to see how Dundin was important not only in the cultural life of Tibet, but also in the social and political life, discourse of the 17th century. So I'm sure there are many questions.
I'd like to say something about the picture in front of me. Because it's 8-footed, I think because it's supposed to be 8-footed, it's not in the picture, but in the poem it is. Is that correct? So I think some Indologists will recognize that as the Sharabha, which is always 8-footed, I think. But in Tibetan context, it's one of the six gyan that go around a figure of the Buddha or whatever. And that's where you see it most often, as a kind of a standing off to the side of the throne, as the element of this, the backing of the Buddha image. One of the six. And actually the Garuda is at the very top, which is a totally separate creature from the Sharabha.
Thank you. in reality, so it doesn't look like this usually. But it does have 8 feet, so I can't resist the idea that the 8 feet are definitely directing your mind to the Sharba.
Includes actually the Garuda's 2 legs, but some way this artist didn't, we don't see here, but in the explanation of this Beju said this is the creature.
But that adds up to 6.
Yeah.
And you need
no,
8.
That's having 8 because you count the wings as 2 and then the feet of the Garuda.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah.
I've never heard of that, but it's probably true. But the Sharba is also a composite creature. Just what exactly the parts of it are is not so clear to me.
One interesting thing I just in the course of reading Kamdru's commentary on Kavya Dasha that I noticed is sort of like this sectarian affiliation, right? One thing that one noticed is when Kamdru's commentary seems that he plays very high value on Pukepa's poems, both of them belonging to the Kagyu tradition. And then when he talks about Dalai Lama, it's always somewhat mixed. I wouldn't say that all of the time he's criticizing him, but there are numerous examples I won't refer to. But then sometimes also it comes to my mind that there is some form of impartiality. That's an element in that as well. For instance, there are places where he would criticize Pukepa. I think perhaps Kamdru represents this later generation of scholars who have more knowledge of Sanskritic learning. And then in the citation of poems, sometimes he would, sometimes he would cite the 8th Garmapa Ramjun Dorje. So then here you can see, okay, he's citing a teacher who belongs to the same tradition, the Kagyu. But then he also cites from Tsongkhapa. So then I thought that there's this mixture of things. So just wondering if Pema could comment on that as well. So this religious sectarian affiliation, the role of that in the practice of poetry.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean. Mm-hmm. Actually, I'm not sure Dalai Lama criticized specifically Pukepa. Pukepa born after 2 years, Dalai Lama's birth. And Pukepa read his commentary after 30 years of Dalai Lama's commentary. That way, I think Dalai Lama is really little chance to criticize specifically Pukepa. But he really, really, he's really rude to Kwaju school in the commentary we read together many, many times.
Many more.
Many more.
It's pure rudeness. Uh-huh. I didn't think it was
not only the vampires, include all famous masters, Kwajipas. That's where I think, when Dalai Lama criticizes and Pukepa is building up his anger, I think. Then later, after 30 years, then he wrote. But later, I think Dalai Lama also changed. He values this kind of conventional terminology stuff. Also, he changed his attitude, the poets from Kajipa, the Karmapa Chivarpa, Michu Dorji, who's exiled in almost the whole life.
The Karmapa was exiled by the fifth
Dalai Lama. Yeah. He's ran away for whole life. And he called himself, there's no one artist and poet like me in Tibet. And he called himself, he positioned like that. And then later, Dalai Lama's end of the life, he called, come back to meet me. And he went to, Dalai Lama went to meet him and brought him back. I think he the attitude towards two poets and artists, he changed a lot later. I'm not sure, did I answer your question?
In our conversation, he said to me that in the end, the Dalai Lama valued, it was more important for him to have a good poet in the court than to keep up this kind of sectarian dispute.
Just on the body ornament soul issue, there's an exactly analogous, whether it's related historically or not, exactly analogous development in the Indian tradition, and especially in Kashmir, this idea that you have to have a body and an ornament and a soul, and it's really the soul that gets ornamented, not the body. That's why we don't decorate dead bodies, and that's why Abhinavagupta says an ornament on a shramana, I think is his word, is ridiculous, whereas on, so yeah, because of a transformation in the person's soul. I mean, what you say about this, the medical commentator, it sounds as if he had read the, you know, the Dvanyaloka or something.
Well, that's a big question.
Yeah.
In Tibetan history.
But we also saw something very similar in Anne's presentation in the Viracholia, even at that point. There is this earlier idea, and you have this fivefold category much, much earlier, right? And it was body, rhythm, and breath or life force or something as the five categories of poetry. So it seems that there's this constant desire to inject this breath or life force. It also comes up in the Siya Bhaskara, if I'm not mistaken. Or wasn't there something about the breath?
Prana.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So where this Tibetan medical commentator is exactly getting it, that's a question. But it could also have just been, as he was accused of, that he's looking at life. In fact, life is a huge issue for him, obviously, being a physician.
Could the word potentially be Atma?
Atma.
I mean, that's
no.
Why? It can't.
Atma?
Yeah. Could the
actually, okay, so there's a whole big deal on the word soul. It doesn't have a direct analog in Sanskrit. But it's sort of thought to be the older Tibetan word before Buddhism comes, when they say there's no, and then you then get this new language of Atman. So why do you ask that question?
Well, because it's Kavyanama is the thing that's at issue.
In Abhinava?
Yeah.
That he calls it Atman.
Yeah. I mean, is it the fact that, is it the Buddhist allergy to talking about Atmans that could be at play here?
That's a good point. Tejas? This is a very rich category, and exactly how it's functioning, I don't know. So, but I will look at the Abhinava for sure.
Thank you for this very, very interesting and stimulating talk, both of you. My first response is, why can't we get somebody like the fifth Dalai Lama to rule us? My second response, believe me, my second response is that it's a comment, that it's just amazing how the Kavya Darsha supplied not just imagery and not just vocabulary and not just final vocabulary, but kind of deep modes of thinking and expressing oneself in this court culture. It's beyond the imagination of Dundin, I think. What the impact on thinking and on speaking, cultured speech in Tibet. So that's a comment, and there's a question about this verse, the Lesha verse. So you kept saying that this is a way of saying without saying, but this being an example of Ninda in disguise is it is saying. It is saying something about, maybe it's not saying because it's not mentioning the direct object of the dig, but there's no question that this is Ninda. So it brings me back to your question, Janet, of how if there is a possibility of also a light side to this very serious debate.
I mean, in this case, you really can read the line in two different ways. You know, he didn't practice inner yoga, wow, he's amazing. Or he didn't practice inner yoga, well, that's really amazing, but he still thinks he knows something.
But it's an example for
more a device, a rhetorical device of condemning something.
That's right, yeah.
So the context tells you it has to be.
But in this case, he does it so safely that it might not actually seem to be a condemnation. So I think he's hiding the fact that he's using Leisha because he's doing it in a way that it could be read in the other way.
Isn't that how Leisha's supposed to work? It's like a joke grenade, right?
Yeah, but his point is that when you put it in a book and you say this is Leisha, you're saying there's an implicit blame for somebody in this verse.
Which is true for him as well, because it's in that same place.
Yeah.
Okay, all right. But is if it's a joke, I don't know. Pamela, would you like to comment that other people also feel they're kind of playing with each other?
No, yeah. Because it's as a Buddhist, Tibetan Buddhist, the inner what? Inner what? Say?
Which one?
Can I say? Inner realization? Can I say?
Yeah.
Meditation, inner meditation. That's one commonly understand most important to learn Kapidasha. That's common. As a religious person, especially for a Dalai Lama, he needs Kapidasha. Because as a big Lama, he need to write a lot of prayers. When Lama dies, he need to write a prayer for incarnation come back. And somebody chief that he need to write a prayer for will born in some good place. He need that as a tool. He need Kapidasha. But without religions, meditator, that's all of them useless. He need power inside. That's why without that you learn Kapidasha. That's useless. Yeah, that's some kind of.
Serious criticism.
This was really interesting, and I just want to ask a question out of kind of complete ignorance. You mentioned in passing messenger poems, and I was interested in the relationship between Sanskritic forms and something like working on the Kavya Darsha and composing something like a messenger poem. Do they exist in the same sort of spaces where there's this going back and forth between political themes and poetic themes? What sort of spaces do Sanskritic poetic models operate in? Are they similar?
In general, when are Sanskritic poetic devices used in Tibetan writing?
Well, I guess specifically messenger poem writing.
Okay, well, maybe Pema can tell us something about messenger poem. Who wrote it, and why, and how did they use it?
I have. Yeah. One is the Bekiba, the smart Tibetan guy. He wrote one long a title, Chenyi Ngamo Nanzen, something like that. And the person to send, that's he imagined. There are no real person. And the things he expressed is a religion feeling. How this samsara is meaningless. How much he feels lonely, meaningless. That kind of a feeling. And did I answer?
Yeah, I'm not sure what you're asking. I mean, maybe I can just add, in addition to the, so the messenger poem was written by two other people?
Another two people. One is much later, in 20th century. He's also big poet from Gelugpa school. And he wrote to his lama. One of the student, he's a lama, but he's a student. Actually, really, not far away, in Rekong, where I come from. He's upper Rekong, he's a student in lower Rekong. And then he, actually not separated long time, probably half a year. And then he expressed how much he missed him, this teacher read to him. how much missing. And he wrote from upper lecon to lower lecon, looks like he said, a hawk fly 18 months need to, actually these days probably 2 hours drive. He may, there's a river, that river just, it's big, but not, there's no like a boat, that, such things. He made a really big river, and in, there's many boats go around, and a lot of birds, different birds. Yeah, mainly something like that. Another one is in 80s. That poet's still alive. He, that time he was studying in Beijing, and he's from Golo, a nomadic area. He's a really good poet, still alive. He wrote how much he missed his family members in Golo, in Tibet. Yeah, those three.
But one thing we might add is that often the emotion directed at between lovers in Indian poetics is transformed into relationship between student and teacher. That's one of the major ways that this, that kavya poetry is used, as Pema just said, to write praise poems to your teacher, which are super duper over the top, but using the technology of kavya to do so. So, and also in letter writing is another place. It's also used, it's a sign of learning, it's a sign of being cultured. There's a lot to say on this.
Thanks very much for your talk. One of the things that I've been wondering about, frankly, through all the vernacular local language sessions has been whether or not the Kavya Darsha stands alone as an iteration of Alankara Shastra, or whether it comes as part of a package, a broader theoretical package. And given the unique relationship of Tibetan to Sanskrit, I'm wondering what kind of evidence there is for a broader Alankara Shastra package, a broader literary theoretical package that maybe, you know, I'm wondering, does translating or interpreting the Kavya Darsha, is that kind of the flagship noting understanding of a broader capacity in Sanskrit literature and literary production? Otherwise it's hard, you can't write a Sandesha Kavya just from reading Dandan. So I'm wondering what kind of evidence is there, Larry alluded to it and you didn't pick him up on it, what else is being translated, what comes along with Dandan that could also then yield productive Sandesha Kavya?
Nothing theoretical that we know of, but before they translated Kavya Darsha, they translated all of the Buddhist scriptures, and there are poetic works, Buddhist poetic works, Matricheta, Kshemendra, such things have been translated into Tibetan. There is a Tibetan translation of the Ramayana. So there's example of poetry, and in Buddhist sutras galore. There's all kinds of Indian poetry, but there's no other technical work that we know of. Yes. Yeah. So there's translation of actual examples of poetry, like you were talking about last night, the practice of it, but not
no other shastra.
I think that we know of. This is a big question, and you know, in invoking Abhinava, this is a question. You know, why did the Tibetans not pay attention to Abhinava? Because he's so close to their tantric sensibilities. You know, in a period where Tibetans were still crossing the Himalayas and bringing stuff in, but as far as we know, there was no trans, even knowledge of him really. So that's why I'm really not very sure.
There are at least some manuscripts of Bamaha that are recovered in Tibet, I think. But there's in that Chinese the list of the stuff that's in Beijing. Okay. There's at least one, I think, a couple manuscripts of Bamaha in Sanskrit, not completed.
That came from Tibet.
Nyoli's manuscript came from. Yeah. Isn't that where Nyoli's manuscript of the Ramayana came from? Didn't it come from?
No.
Well, one of the things we've talked about before is when the Kavya Darsha was translated, this Tibetan translator was sent to Nepal, and he studied with several Indian teachers to do the translation. So one of the hypotheses is he was in some kind of context where there was a lot of give and take, and maybe he also knew about all kinds of other works as well. But and he did the Tibetans were also, as we learned from Dragomir's talk, the Tibetans were very familiar with Ratna Sri, although they didn't actually translate it. So there's that.
Question, a general remark and a question, but seeing all these translations of Dandin, I think of similar phenomenon in Europe. One of the texts which has been most translated is the Ars Minor of Donatus. It's a text which starts with a Partes orationis quod sunt, it's a question, and then the answer, octo. And then this text has been promoted by Charlemagne, Karl der Große, from the Carolingian period. And in the Middle Ages, the expression donatus started to mean grammar. So you can have a donat français, which means a grammar for French. And of course, when you translate, so translating the Donatus amounted to writing a grammar of that language. Now, of course, there are specificities of languages. There are not always eight parts of speech, etc. So in the case of the Dandin translation, when you translate, for instance, those gunas which have a close relationship with the phonological inventory, what are the difficulties when you go to Tibetan, for instance?
Yeah, that's something that I've been thinking about a lot. The Tibetan language was very much transformed. This is way before Dandin was introduced, but in the process of translating all the Sanskrit and Prakrit and Buddhist hybrid Sanskrit and so on, and Apabhramsha stuff into Tibetan, the Tibetans devised, you know, a system of the eight cases, for example, that mapped onto Sanskrit ones. That also was discussed. That's another thing for us to study further. That was mentioned as a problem by Sakya Pandita, who's the first Tibetan guy who knew of or talked about the Kavya Darsha, as the sounds of Tibetan are quite different. But when they're translating or they're giving examples of Shabda Alamkara, they use Tibetan kinds of examples, which make sense in Tibetan. And we've seen this now in other cases as well.
Dragyan,
Dragyan,
the first, Sakya Pandita said not possible at the beginning. But, Yundenchu. Yundenchu what?
So the general issue.
Yeah, you are right. There's Tibetan traditional Tibetan poets. We divide two schools. When, like we mentioned here, Dalai Lama and this Bhikkhuva, there are two in Nyangar Melong, Kapi Dasha, the two things. One is Loba and the Sherpa.
Galdia and Vai.
Yeah. This fifth Dalai Lama and the seventh, there's a Bhikkhuva, we considered Sherpa. Really hard to understand. And like Tsongkhapa and the Gongtang, and there's a group of poets called, we think, is a Loba.
More like Vai Darbi.
Yeah.
We have to stop.
So thank you for a wonderful debate. So we move further north to consider the impact of Indian poetics and Dandin on Mongolia. And our next speaker is Professor Vesna Wallace from the University of California, Santa Barbara. Her topic is the Kavya Dasha in Mongolia.
Yeah, it's more about the reception of Kavya Dasha. When Yigal kindly invited me to take a part in this conference, I was initially very reluctant. First, because Kavya Dasha has not been a topic of my inquiry. And second, I wasn't sure what will I find anything in Mongolia. But after beginning to look at this, I found overwhelming amount of material. And so what I will present today is really based on this preliminary research. So what I will do is tell you a little bit how Kavya Dasha came into Mongolia, what were the primary influential figures that came, whose commentary in Tibetan became influential in Mongolia, what are the main, most important commentaries in Mongolia, and then we will look in different samples. So for nearly 3.5 centuries, beginning from the late 17th century, the study of Dandin's Kavya Dasha in Mongolia was carried out primarily in Buddhist monastic centers. All the Mongolian Buddhist authors' interest in the Kavya Dasha originally stemmed from their monastic training in the Shabda Vidya. Their fascination with it was also rooted in the fact that Mongolian literary tradition was primarily a poetic tradition, which hardly had any pure prose. The frequent inclusions of poetry in prose texts and the fluent boundaries between verse and rhythmicized prose resulted in the prosaic-poetic hybridization of diverse genres of the Mongolian prose literature. And even today you will find people, especially in elderly generation, who communicate only in verse. And almost every second Mongolian is writing a poetry. It is so deeply embedded in their culture. Copious examples in the writings of the Mongolian Buddhist authors demonstrate the high degree to which the Kavya Dasha was instrumental in the development of the Mongolian poetic tradition. Numerous versified eulogy, prayers, verses recited at the time of ritual offerings, benedictions in colophons, and other poetic works written by Mongolian scholars of the late 17th through the early 20th centuries evidence both the author's attempts to follow Dandin's principle of alamkaras and the influence of other principles of the Kavya Dasha on their writings. For example, Dandin's definition of poetry, how does this work? It's stuck. So the Dandin's definition of poetry given in the Kavya Dasha chapter 1, verse 11, Pada B, according to, as you know, Padyam Chatushpadita Chavartam Jyatri Dvitha, in which Padya is defined as having the four lines, directly affected the structure of Mongolian Buddhist poetry through centuries, which has been almost invariably written in quatrains. Here is just one of the examples, which comes from the collection of verses composed by Chahar Geshe Lutsal Tsultrim, who lived in the late 18th and early 19th century, which is written in four lines, having 9 syllables each. And since then, every poet in Mongolia wrote exactly in the same form. As you can see, it reads, "Gracious Guru, who grants all wishes from now on, in every circumstances of joy and sorrow, having dwelt with your kindness in the center of my heart, please bless me that my thoughts and actions accord with the Dharma." The popular practice of composing poetic works in quatrains expanded beyond monastic settings, being widely used in other contexts in the Mongolian literary tradition, such as shamanic and folk poetic traditions. And its influence still can be seen in contemporary writings. Dandin's Kavya Dasha was translated into the Mongolian language in the first half of the 18th century. It's relatively late comparing to Tibet. At the time of the formation of the Mongolian Danjur, it was translated by Mongolian translator from Halha by name Gelek Jaltsan. In his rendering of the Kavya Dasha, Gelek Jaltsan closely followed the Tibetan version, utilizing the old method of word-for-word translation from the Tibetan, which was otherwise no longer in vogue during that period. At the time of the formation of the Mongolian Danjur, the principle of adverbum translation, which had been applied earlier to the translation of the Ganjur, was replaced by contextual method of translation because the previous method resulted in both stylistically awkward and semantically unclear readings. Although Gelek Jaltsan's translation of the Kavya Dasha is some places correct, his word-for-word translation violated the norms of the Mongolian literary language, making it at times difficult to understand, if not completely incomprehensible. Another unusual feature of Gelek Jaltsan's translation of the Kavya Dasha is that he often literally rendered proper names, figures of speech, metonyms, and the like, from the Tibetan, even when there were Mongolian equivalents for the corresponding Tibetan and Sanskrit terms. By his time, the standard rule of translation from Tibetan into Mongolian, which was created specifically for the translation of the Tibetan Tengyur into the Mongolian, was to use Mongolian equivalents for Sanskrit technical terms, personal names, names of deities, and natural phenomena, or to retain Sanskrit terms when Mongolian equivalents were not found. But because of the way how Gelek Jaltsan was translation, the vocabulary he used in this rendering of Kavya Dasha never penetrated the Mongolian language. And this is maybe the reason why Mongolian authors never studied Mongolian version of the Kavya Dasha, but rely completely on the Tibetan. And so I would like to give you an example. Here is an example again of the chapter 1, verse 11, where he slavishly followed the Tibetan reading, literally translating each segment of the Tibetan terms and phrases, for which reason then the whole reading of this text in Mongolian is utterly incomprehensible. First of all, Tibetan term for translating a padyam or the verse is tikche. Now, if you were to, and every Tibetologist or every Tibetan when sees this term will know it means verse. If you were to translate it kind of etymologically, cutting this word, tikt would mean link, a member, and che means cut off or broken. So instead of then using, in a Mongolian translation, instead of using this standard Mongolian term, which by the way is shiluk, which is a kind of Mongolized Sogdian version of shloka, but we came to designate any kind of verse. Well, he translates it as tasugusan, which means cut off, and there should be then uyen, which means limb. So cut off limb means nothing to any Mongol. And then for gadyam, lukpa is in Tibetan, and he translates it that even doesn't correspond to Tibetan, rukuljileksen, which means continued or prolonged. Now, another problem is, okay, Tibetan here seems to use deyang a couple of times for cha, even though, again, standard meaning is moreover, but he didn't know what to do with this either, so he translated as tegundur, which means with respect to that. So with respect to that where cha should be. So again, makes no sense in the reading. But now, when I look at it, I said, where is the uyen? There is no uyen, there is uilen. And here, where should be, right, translation of padya, and uilen means karma. So first I said, okay, here we have a typographical error. But the more I looked, I saw scribal authorship. That is to say, scribe who had to write, copy the text on a very thin paper, which would then put on a wooden block. And so this is how these letters would be carved in the wooden block. And scribes in Mongolia are very highly educated men. They oftentimes would get positions in the government because they were very literate and so on. So he must have looked in this word and said, this makes no sense. So instead of Wien, he wrote Wielen. And now actually, then the longer I looked, I said, oh, it says, with regards to that, something consists of three kinds. That is to say, cut-off karma, continued karma, and mixed karma. Poor Dandin. And so it is not clear why, in the case of the Kavyadasha, Galag-Jelsen held onto a method of translation that was already deemed ineffective and has been abandoned by his colleagues. It appears, though, as here is one small example, that in some instances, if not in many, he didn't understand the lines he was translating. And here, too, here we have from chapter 1, part 32, verse 32, Pada B, where we have those list of, you know, four languages. So where it is apapramshascha mishram cheti ahuravtascha turvidham. Here, as if he suddenly looked into Sanskrit, he gets here, which means cognate to cha, but then he obviously knew here about Sandhi or something, but then he writes za, so it says something, and then iti, luge means with, so it says the wise taught four kinds together with apapramsha, mixed, and so here Mishra, he actually writes this way before he wrote his Havaguksan, and then N plus Za. He thought Za is some kind of a language or something. Didn't recognize it as a copula. So it was kind of hard to read this text, believe me. But even before Galag-Jelsen's translation was made available, Mongolian Buddhist scholars had become well acquainted with the Kavyadasha through the Tibetan translations of this text and through indigenous Tibetan commentaries on it. However, it is plausible that already in the Yuan court of the 13th century and slightly some Mongolian scholars had access to the Kavyadasha in its first complete Tibetan version, which was produced sometime between 1258 and 1280 by the Tibetan translator Shonten Dorje Gyaltsen and the Nepalese Pandit Lakshmikara. And we have mentioned here, right in previous, on the initiative of Kublai Khan's imperial preceptor of religious affairs, Sakya Lama Pakpa, and his disciple Sakya Zangpo. Along with Shonton's 13th century translation of the Kavyadasha, the 17th century Tibetan commentaries on the Kavyadasha had a significant role to play in the early development of Mongolian studies of the Kavyadasha and in the influence on Mongolian authors who primarily wrote in the Tibetan language. The most, let's see if I have them here. So yeah, the most influential among them were already mentioned Pokemipam, two commentaries, the introductory commentary on the Kavya Mahashastra Darsha, an ornament of Dhanin Sot, and a good explanation of examples shown by the basic text of the Kavya Darsha, a ford of the ocean of melodies, then a commentary by the fifth Dalai Lama on the difficult points of the Kavya Darsha, a song that delights Saraswati, and composed in 1647, in Mahapandita Lobsang Norbu's examples of the 35 Alamkaras. So inspired by the aforementioned Mahapandita Lobsang Norbu's work and the fifth Dalai Lama's interpretation, perhaps the earliest Mongolian commentator, so far he appears to be the earliest, on the Kavyadasha was a Halhazaya Pandita Lobsang Prenle, who lived in the late 17th and early 18th century, the head of Zainhure Monastery. He wrote a short text in the Tibetan language titled Examples. Let's see if I have it. Examples of the 35 Alankaras, a melody that delights Saraswati. During his stay in Tibet between 1660 and 1679, Zaya Pandita also studied the Kavya Darsha under the tutelage of the Tibetan teacher Lobsang Chodrak. From the 18th to the early 20th century, many Mongolian scholars composed not only numerous poetic works related to the Kavya Darsha in the Tibetan language, but also commentaries on the text in Tibetan with Dandins in their own versified examples of Alankaras. In this way, these authors contributed not only to Mongolian poetics as familiar to the Mongolian scholars trained in the Tibetan language, but also to Tibetans' own studies of the Kavya Darsha. As you will see, some will be criticizing and trying to revise some of Tibetan commentators. Among them, okay, worthy of mention are some. There are so many, so okay, I can. The first one is one of the previously mentioned Chahar Geshe Lusan Tsultrim, who also authored two commentaries on the Kavya Darsha, and I won't give you this long title, then Alashar Haram Bhagwan Dandar, who after studying the Kavya Darsha in Mongolia, traveled at the age of 50 to Tibetan monasteries in central Tibet and Namdo in search of scholars learned in the Kavya Darsha, and he pursued his further study of Dandin poetics in Lapran Tashikiel Monastery in Namdo. Upon his return to Mongolia, he wrote three works related to the Kavya Darsha. One is a commentarial work composed in 1829, titled An Elegant Pearl Garland to Ornament the Neck, Illuminating the Knowledge of Examples from the Three Chapters of the Kavya Darsha, in which he also gave examples of verses related to the topics of all three chapters of the Kavya Darsha. His second work is a poetic composition in which he illustrates the 35 Alankaras with the stanzas of a single poem that eulogizes the body, mind, and learning of his Tibetan teacher, Lhondrom Navang Lobsang. And the third text is titled A River of Devotion that flows into the ocean of excellent qualities, a note of praise to the guru by means of example. But as we will see, other Mongolian authors also sought to demonstrate their poetic skill by making use of all the Alankaras within a single poem. In Agwandandar's third work, titled The Melodious Symphony that Calls Out for Blessings, a hymn of praise to my guru by means of clarifying speech that is a likeness to the second chapter of the Kavya Darsha, Agwandandar composed 77 verses of praise to his previously mentioned teacher, adapting them to 77 forms of sounds in order to illustrate the Alankaras and to show the similarities between his own examples and those given in the Kavya Darsha. From among the 77 verses in his collection, 66 are his own composition and 11 other verses that he cited from the commentaries, from the commentary written by the Tibetan scholar Navang Drakpa. Another Mongolian scholar who authored similar works related to the Kavya Darsha is so-called Vangai Rabjaba or Rabjempa Agwan Tunde. In addition to his two commentaries on the text, oh, the titles are so long, so I won't maybe bother you. But what the two titles show is what was their main concern, and this always seems to be Alankaras. So in addition to the commentaries that you see here on the screen, he also composed an ode to the goddess Tara by making use of the 35 Alankaras to demonstrate both his poetic skill and to exemplify the manner in which all 35 Alankaras can be applied to single poetic work. The title of his ode is Songs of the Messenger of Spring, who brings the festival of new benefits, a praise to Sri Tara by means of the 35 Alankaras. So there are other commentators, and I don't want to take too much time, but here, I think I mentioned these. It's just for you to kind of get a little sense. But So among the 20th century authors, the most influential was a man by name Javiangara, who is here last on the list, Suren Horin, popularly known as an Erden Bandita Hanchin Hambo, who wrote a very famous, in Mongolia, famous work called Brahma's Melody, a general explanation of the root text and commentary on poetics, which was block printed in sometime after 1904. In this work, Javiangara examined interpretations given in various Tibetan commentaries. He also pointed out the errors in their understandings, presented his own interpretations, which he supported with the examples taken from original Sanskrit verses. Javiangara's works seems to exceed the limits of a mere commentary on Indian poetics because he also introduced innovations to traditional Mongolian poetical theory that kind of he thought were based on the Kavya Darsha. He introduced new ideas and terminology and showed both from a theoretical point of view and through the example of his own poems, new ways of composing in a verse, and created a compositional style representing the combination of the tender and uniform style of Supumara Sammata by introducing soft consonants into verse. He produced a harsh uniform style, or Madhyama Sammata, by distributing similar soft and hard consonants at the beginning and ending sections of each stanza. And he produced a harsh, also uniform style, or Sputa Sammata, by introducing hard consonants and Madhyama Sammata. In Javiangara's view, a correct understanding of the first chapter of the Kavya Darsha implies that one should bring the tender, harsh, and medium uniform styles into each verse of a single poem. He claims that it should not be interpreted in the one-sided manner of earlier Tibetan commentators who preceded Bokhem Ipam. According to Javiangara, on the basis of such interpretation by these commentators, they wrote their stanzas only in a medium uniform style and thus restricted the range of stylistic possibilities. 10 minutes, okay, In his study of Shlesha, as he studied it from both Kavya Darsha and various earlier and later Tibetan commentaries, only Javiangara agreed with the previously mentioned Bokhem Ipam and with the 19th century Tibetan theorist, Jangchen Gyavelo Wodrul Tempa, that even when there are mainly soft consonants and only few hard consonants, there is still Shlesha, he claimed. In this regard, he rebutted the view of the Tibetan theorist Jenchen Khache, who held that the essential nature of Shlesha consists of hard consonants, and he also criticized Shongtun Dorje Gyaltsen's translation of the Kavya Darsha, especially chapter 1, verses 42 and 43. Javiangara held that there is a compositional style in which the Tibetan hard consonants and the 15 hard consonants of the Sanskrit alphabet and the soft sound la frequently occur in a harmonious manner in different words in a Tibetan verse. So he rejected the position of the early Tibetan commentators that la only occurs in the Gauda exposition compositional style, and he provided this verse as his example, showing that la can be, let's say, replaced by the soft consonant na, which reads an adorn with many kinds of ornaments, manifesting its innate space, frolicking in manifold manifestations, bring about sharp discernment by means of a yogini. And then to illustrate how the Vaidarbha compositional style may also look, Javiangara wrote this verse. To further illustrate the application of different alamkaras, Javiangara wrote verses on historical themes, because he was a monk. So, and Mongolians in general didn't write erotic poetry. This was a heroic culture. So you are sissy if you write about romance and so on. So he wrote then on this historical theme depicting certain events in the life of different Mongol Hans. For instance, making use of the Lesha Alamkara, he wrote about Ogodei Hans' joyous laughter upon converting to the Dharma, and about Godan Han's invitation to Sakya Pandita to move at the borders of China, Tibet, and Mongolia. With Krama, he wrote about Kublai Khan spreading both the Dharma and state law. With Urjasvi, he wrote about the Queen Manduhai, who after the Oirats came under her power, promised not to harm persons who abide by the emperor's law and to show them compassion. So this goes on, and I will not, because of time restrictions, but I'll give you at least a couple of examples. So making use of Hetu, and I'm not inventing applying this Alamkaras to him, rather he's claiming to be those illustrations. So he said, making use of Hetu, he wrote this verse about the legend of Genghis Khan's ancestor Alungo, told in the secret history of the Mongols. So while the queen Alungo, without a husband, because she wasn't married yet then, was in a dream, she engaged in a sexual delight with the deity. Her joy and happiness increased at the same time. Then she got a son, and after the newborn came the brave hero Bodonchar, who became a major ancestor of Genghis Khan. But also in this verse, which you will see now in the previous, again you will see four lines with nine syllables each. So lastly, utilizing Shlesha, Jamyangara wrote a verse based on the event described in the orally transmitted legend about the Undergegen Zanabazar, who was the first in the lineage of heads of Buddhism among Halhas, who, with his seven attendants, while journeying to Tibet, transformed themselves into flying geese and were noticed by the old couple who was looking after their goats and who showed them then respect. However, so it looks, it's a story about Undergegen Zanabazar, but when he said, the exalted one, you are not the Lord of Man, a Supreme Son, he's no longer really addressing the Undergegen Zanabazar, the son of Tushet Khan Gombodarj, but actually an accomplished yogi who attained the city of transformation. To also demonstrate an application of Tulya Yogita, Visanger, Jamyangama wrote a verse in which he criticizes the moral decline of Mongolian society of his time, pointing out the similar condition of moral corruption of different members of his society. Like cunning women are fixated on alcohol and the appearance of this life, the king's conduct is evil, and the minds of common people are perverse. The sanghas are contentious and neglect the precepts. The wise say these are the causes of ruin for the doctrine and society. But where is Jamyangara most interesting, to me at least, is that he inspired new innovations to later then innovation and inspiration to the poets of the early 20th century and even the middle 20th century. It's a time when came into literary scene Mongolian poets such as Danzan Ozer in Shtavhai, who closely studied the Kavya Darsha and endeavored to apply its principle in their anthology of poetry written on the theme of peace, or White Lotus of Peace, because this was a time in Mongolia when the winds of communist revolution were hit and the Second World War was already there. So, the poem was initially written in Tibetan, then later in 1959 in its Mongolian translation. So following the principle of the Kavya Darsha, Shtavhai and Danzan Ozer also composed odes to Tara and Manjushri. But there is a new form that at some point emerged, which was kind of inspired by Dandin, but not maybe directly based. You will all know better than I. And this is the began to experiment with composing verses by following the rule which they call Samanta Bhadra's wheel, which involves creating the meaning of a stanza by switching or changing the word order, a method which can also be found in other poetry written in the Tibetan Mongolian languages. And this they show as an example of their own Shabda Alam, Alamkara, in a poem which is called Disseminator of Peace and written in a classical Mongolian. So this crossword poem reads from the middle of the four sides to the center. It reads from the four corners to the center, from the middle of the four sides going the clockwise direction, and from the square of the four sides above and below to the middle square. And it's possible because here in the middle there is a verb, which voltugai, which means may there be. So if you read it from this side, right, you will come to voltugai, like Yidem Yosul Mend Anu Voltugai, Voltugai. May there be wisdom, education, and good knowledge, or good health. Or if you read from here, Irk Jargal Minduan Voltugai, may there be power, happiness, and good health. Or if you read it this way, again, from the bottom up, what does it read? I can see from this side. Gai Hamshing Yosu Mend Anu Voltugai. May there be the marvelous law and good health. And so you can go this way, you can go that way, in all kinds of direction you will get to some meaning. And what is interesting is that in the first three manners of reading, this poem has four stanza. But in the last, fourth manner of reading, it has 18 stanzas. In this way, it has altogether 20 stanzas. And that also inspired the famous poet and scholar of the same period, Rinchen Byambin, who also wrote his poem in a similar manner, but in now more kind of modern Mongolian, called Princess, also with Shabda Alankara. Oh, I forgot to show you, to pay also, to bring your attention here, that we have here two same words, Irdem, Irdem. We have here, two, in this corner, Irhem, Irhem. We have Inke, Inke, and then Ba, Ba. And then also, if you look, there will be also the way how he plays with words, Chihula, Chihula, Saihan, Saihan. So, okay, 1 minute, and I'm done. Yes, it's finished. And so there was this other poet who tried in modern Mongolian, about the same time, wrote this poem, Princess, which again, you can, applying Shabda Alankara, Shabda Alankara, if you see that words always first line, of two words are always start with the same syllable, that's how it became a very traditional Mongolian way of writing. It's written even today in this manner. And the poem can be also read in several ways. You can either start it from the beginning, from the bottom. The moon suddenly came out of the cloud during a deep night while reaching there around your temple, princess, and goes this way. And it can also be read from these first lines down, or it can be read from the second lines down. Okay, 1 minute. So far what I have presented here are only very few of numerous illustrations of the ways in which the Kavya Darsha influenced and enriched Mongolian poetics and contributed to the development of Mongolian literary tradition. But you see, apart from some very short studies on the place and role in the Kavya Darsha in Mongolian poetics written by Mongolian scholars in the latter part of the 20th century, there has not been any rigorous examination of the aforementioned Mongolian commentaries on the Kavya Darsha or any comprehensive study of the scope of Dandin's influence on Mongolian poetry. So in addition to shedding light on the history of Mongolian poetics and literary composition, such study would also give us better insight into the Kavya Darsha's contribution to the exchange of theoretical views and practical applications of Indian poetics among Tibetans and Mongolian scholars. And I can stop here. Sorry, I have rushed.
Thank you for a wonderful talk. It's really astonishing to discover that Dandin had such an impact into the 20th century on poets working so far away from his native land. So thank you very much. Yeah. So, questions?
I have that. Thank you. Yeah, thank you. This was fascinating. Two questions. One is about whether the severed limbs at the beginning is really so much of a mistake, because this, I mean, the etymological and historical meaning of padya and pada and these types of words means limbs, right?
Right.
So maybe it means something like articulated limbs, and I don't know if that's something that's there.
No, it really means cut off, broken, interrupted.
I tried.
Both in Tibetan and in Mongolian.
Okay. So the other question is, there's an interesting interaction between Sanskrit, in some ways in the background, but in one case, it was clear that the translator was looking at a Sanskrit text.
Yes.
Then Tibetan, which seems to be the language of a lot of these early commentaries produced in Mongolia and kind of exemplifications of the Kavya Darsha, and then Mongolian, classical Mongolian and modern Mongolian. And I was wondering if you could say something about the interaction between all these languages.
Well, first of all, the Tibetan language was a language of learning in Tibetan monasticism. Doesn't mean that it was, in terms of reading the text, studying the text, and in terms of writing, they themselves have wrote a great deal in the Tibetan, thousands of volumes, actually. But when teachings were given, they're always given in a colloquial Mongolian language. So that even certain schools of oral translations have eventually developed, in which translators have played with this game of words, and they would teach, or they would be orally, when giving a, let's say, lecture in a class, would actually translate orally something that is in the Tibetan to especially younger students who didn't know yet Tibetan, and then they would compete among these different lineages, and they would compete who will be translating the better beginning each line of verse with the same letter, and you know, using different kind of ornaments and so on. But modern Mongolian language was always there, kind of in use, except the script. Right, script has changed in 1945. Then the Cyrillic script was imposed by Soviets, which kind of also changed the language somewhat. But in terms of vocabulary, today, even in modern Mongolian language, you will find lots of Sanskrit terminology. Some came through Sogdian, and some came directly from Sanskrit. And it's easy, actually, to trace them. But also, you can find some Tibetan vocabulary, particularly in the context of rituals, then Tibetan vocabulary appears.
I just have two little formal questions. So first,
which one? I can't move it.
This is fine. No, the initial, but the initial consonant or initial, just initial sound rhyme, is that, so this is something, is this typical of Tibetan or, sorry, Mongolian, or is it something
sound?
That's inventive? The initial rhyme. Because as we've talked about a couple times, rhyme is, it's everywhere in Dravidian languages, so it's just curious to me.
Mongolians, maybe you will know more about Tibetan, but Mongolians claim this is their traditional way. Even today, when they're translating, poetry or some kind of versified teachings from the Tibetan language, they still use the same. But then those who are more skilled, they will have the whole stanza beginning with the same.
My actual question follows on that, was whether, since you've made this point about how verse craft is so central to Mongolian culture, is there any effect of this? I mean, when translating something that's maybe in some sense known, remembered to be Indic, is there some effort? Is there a different way? Can you voice an Indian meter in Mongolian, or do they just use?
I think to some degree they are almost maybe forced to, because it's a agglutinative language in which vowel harmony is necessary. So that may kind of mess up a little bit of meter. That's why they focus more on the number of syllables rather than meter itself. Another point I forgot to mention when we are looking at that first example of translation. In a Tibetan language, it is common to have an adjective follow the noun which it describes. In Mongolian, which has a strict word order, adjective always precedes the noun. So when you read also translations in which follows closely Tibetan. They're very awkward. It's like saying, same as in English, if I were to say, oh, apple green, right, instead of green apple. Same awkwardness occurs in Mongolian language.
Thank you.
I was very happy that you mentioned the Konsankolo. You gave a Sanskrit word. Is that a real Sanskrit word? That
Samantabhadra?
Is it just a back translation?
No, they actually Mongolian Samantabhadrin.
Okay. Anyways, in Tibetan Konsankolo. But I wonder, I'm having you mention them. Just I was in Mongolia not so long ago, and I don't remember seeing any on the outside of monasteries like you're used to seeing in monasteries in Tibet. Maybe it's something different about the way the Mongolian monastery is set up, but there's not so much place in the porch area to have these elaborate artistic konsankolas like you see almost everywhere in Nepal and Tibet. There may be some, I don't remember.
Maybe there used to be, but you know, most of these monasteries are now kind of rebuilt, and contemporary monks, young people, or people who used to be lay people before becoming monks, so they have no previous knowledge.
I didn't think about the destruction. I should have, sorry.
So I don't know if I haven't seen myself either.
Okay, so that trilingual situation is very fascinating. It's a little bit reminiscent of Kerala, which has three languages, Sanskrit, Tamil, and Malayalam, and the relations between them also very interesting, but probably very different, I suppose, than in Mongolia. I wondered if, I wasn't sure I heard you correctly, that the exemplary verses to the Dundin categories are actually sometimes at least in Mongolian. That is, that the lists of the alankaras and so on seem to be in Tibetan, Mongolia. Is that right? But the exemplary verses are in Mongolian?
Yeah, they're in Tibetan. Yeah. They're all also in Tibetan.
Everything's in Tibetan. Yeah, so you don't have Mongolian Tibetan verses that are composed in order to apply...
To illustrate, no.
I see. Okay.
Unfortunately. Except that last one,
So this is the first part of my question is to your wonderful talk. I'm so great that you overcame your resistance and came and joined us. So my first part of my question is following up on Andrew's and David's question about this trilingual situation. So it seems like that the Tibetan literary culture was the only mediator for the Kavya Darsha into Mongolia, and that even Sanskrit manuscripts were probably, if they played any part, were brought from Tibet and from Tibetan monastic monasteries. So the question is, were these Tibetan translations and examples books that were produced in Mongolia, did they also participate in the Tibetan literary culture? Or was this like a closer set of the conversations about Dandin? And the second part of my question goes back to a point that Pema and Janet made, that seems a little bit problematized to me by this talk, which is that the monastic setting of Dandin was a little bit outside the monastery. But it seems like that these Mongolian monks went to centers of learning in Tibet, and that's where they got their Dandin. So was it extracurricular or part of the curriculum? So these are my two questions about this back and forth between these two.
The ideal was, and I don't know how it was in different monasteries in Tibet, that ideal carried out, is that ideal of Nalanda's, Panchavidya, actually Dashavidya, but primarily Panchavidya and Shabdavidya was one of those subject matters. I was told by some monks from the Tashikil that they did study when before they came to India, actually, how composition, how you compose a verse. And so this one monk even wrote me a lovely poem to show me how he can write. And he said, oh, you know, fortunately in India, all of this has been lost. They no longer teach this. At that time, I wasn't thinking about Dandin, so I didn't ask, oh, did you actually study Dandin when you were learning this composition in verse? But I remember it was a 3-4 line chaturpadi.
And how about this being a closed set? I mean, how much, from the point of view for these Mongolian writers, how much the audience was also in Tibet of what they were doing, or how much was it in Mongolia?
I think it for both. That's why they wrote in Tibetan.
So people are going back and forth.
Yeah, because.
So it's not a closed set.
Right, exactly.
But about teaching, I'm not sure where they got.
They not only studied in Tibet, sometimes they became teachers in Tibet as well, in Tibetan monasteries. So it was exchange of teachers. And that's why they chose the Tibetan, because Tibetan, then you had a larger audience than.
And there was no resistance in Mongolian literary culture and in literature in Mongolian itself to this crazy Kavya Darsha thing?
No. It wasn't, and the only problem that was raised was during the communist revolution, when communist revolutionists who said, oh, these monks, they're not really patriotic, look, they're illiterate in their own language. That's why even in the, especially like in early 20th centuries, there were monks who wrote Mongolian in a Tibetan script, because they couldn't write it in the classical Mongolian script.
Kavya Darsha as a class, that's privately usually, not in monastery. Yeah, you have to contact a different individual. in your list,
yeah,
is Dendar Tarumba and then Sopo Geshi. All this, the had private teacher, learned from private teacher, not in monastery.
No, but this was, the teacher was in a monastery, right?
In monastery, but you have to, cannot include in monastery curriculum.
Mm-hmm. So in other words, there's classes, this is after school, privately in the room, or in another place. It's not part of the monastic curriculum.
They're
the same people, mm-hmm. But it's not officially part of the curriculum, especially in the Gelupa monasteries, right?
Yeah.
The Gelupa monasteries, they're famous for not being able to write at all.
Uh-huh. Well, I think for Mongolians, composition, writing was extremely important, and I wanted something also to say for the, just my turn, lost my thought, okay, I'll remember. Yeah, that the whole I have not access to catalog of Mongolian danjur, but the way how Mongolian lamas speak about it and the scholars as well, that the whole danjur is structured according to the 10 vidyas. Like it's structured according to the first five primary fields of knowledge, and then the five secondary fields of knowledge.
That's a very small part of the
gender. But they say this is, if you look in the general structure, that's a structure.
I think we'll take just one more.
I agree with Janet and Pema Bum. Anyways, the Gelupa monasteries were de-emphasizing this kind of study, but that's, I think, some reason why in the 18th century some central Tibetans or some people from the Lhasa area went to Mindro Ling, which is a monastery, to study those subjects. And in earlier days, you could point to Bodong A as being a real center of Sanskritic poetic studies that has had a very long tradition, starting with Pang Lotsawa and going in nephew succession with the abbots of Bonong A was the most important group of Indologists in that period of Tibetan history.
So in Mongolia, Gelupa Center, Gelupa Monastery was the centers of learning, whereas Kagyu Nyima, because they never had pure Kagyu, pure Nyima, it was always mixed. They were like poor monks who were bards, traveling bards, and making connections with communities and surviving in these ways. But in there is a Lama of Gobi, this Kagyu Nyima Lama, Dandzen Ravdja, who lived the late 19th, early 20th century. He was the only monk who actually wrote one poem, which is kind of not erotic, but maybe extolling the beauty of a woman, a female lover. But actually, it's about an emptiness. And he composed even music about it. And every Mongolian can sing it, even small child can sing it. It's like a national anthem. But yeah, you don't, even in a secular poetry, you don't find much of a kind of erotic or romantic love. Just not a Mongolian. You may find a poetry about the beauty of a nature or mother's love or father's love, but not lover's love. Yeah? No? There was one.
Okay.
Just a few brief comments. You mentioned the Tibetan translation, that it was done by Shong Turner and by the Nepalese Pandit Lakshmikara. He wasn't Nepalese, he was Indian, at least in the sources which I'm aware of. And you also mentioned that the translation was done between 1258 and 1280. I have written extensively on this, both in German and in English. I think it should be dated slightly later. Yeah, the translation was prepared.
Because one of them died by that time, that's why I can look
as
in
far,
my
well, as far as I'm aware, the translation was prepared sometime in the end of the 1260s, in the beginning of the 1270s. And afterwards, the Bodhisattva of Dhanakalpata was translated by the same two translators. And concerning what Igar was asking, where this text was studied in Tibet and in Mongolia.
Mm-hmm.
Well, we know for sure that at least in the good old times, this text was studied intensively by the very best Sanskritists in Tibet. So, of course, it wasn't something for casual monks. It was something for good Sanskritists. And any of the biggest, of the most notable Sanskritists dealt with this text and with the other important Sanskrit texts on Kavya. Meghaduta is part of the Tanjore. Amarakosha as the exemplary work on lexicography. The Chanduratnakara, the work on metrics. So this was the corpus of texts which all these people, like Panklodzava, and then Shalolodzava in the 15th, 16th century, Nietank Lodzava, the fourth Stiramati, and then, of course, in the 18th century, Sito Panchen and his student, Tenzin Chokinima. All these Sanskritists did study the text, and they wrote either commentary on it or they prepared a bilingual edition in Sanskrit and in Tibetan. But I don't want to spend more time on this. I've written about this in my publication, so anyone who is interested is welcome to read these chapters there.
Yeah, I'll then look back and find my footnote and tell you why I came to that conclusion. So, because one of them already dead by 1280, so it couldn't have been anyway.
There's no difference. You said between 1253 and 1280.
Yes.
He said around 1269 or 1270.
Oh, okay.
So you're
yeah. Then that's yeah. That's. Yeah.
To Nepal after 1265. There's some historical documents which we could take notice of.
Well, then maybe Mongolians didn't know also that Lakshmikara was Indian, because they always referred to him as Nepalese. So I don't know.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
That was wonderful. So thank you for a wonderful talk, and we take a break of half an hour, and after that we head east to to China and Japan at 4:30.
I don't like my memory. Nobody's responding.